reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. In those days, the princess said to the king, Jeremiah out to be put to death. He is demoralizing the soldiers who are left in this city and all the people by speaking such things to them. He is not interested in the welfare of our people, but in their ruin. King Zedekiah answered, He is in your power, for the king could do nothing with them. And so they took Jeremiah and threw him in the cistern of Prince Malchiah, which was in the quarters of the guard, letting him down with ropes. There was no water in the cistern, only mud, and Jeremiah sank into the mud. Ebed-Melech, a court official, went there from the palace and said to him, My lord, these men have been at fault. In all they have done to the prophet Jeremiah, casting him into the cistern, he will die of famine on the spot, for there is no more food in the city. Then the king ordered Ebed-Melech, the Cushite, to take three men along with him and draw the prophet Jeremiah out of the cistern before he should die. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us rid ourselves of every burden and sin that clings to us and persevere in running the race that lies before us while keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, the leader and perfecter of faith. For the sake of the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame, and has taken his seat at the right of the throne of God. Consider how he endured such opposition from sinners in order that you may not grow weary and lose heart in your struggle against sin. You have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. The word of the Lord.
My friends, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus said to his disciples, "I have come to set fire to the earth, and how I wish it was already blazing. There's a baptism with which I must be baptized, and how great is my anguish until it is accomplished. Do not think that I have come to establish peace on the earth. No, I tell you, rather not peace, but division. And from now on, the household of five will be divided. Three against two against three. A father divided against his a son against his father. A mother against her daughter, and a daughter against her mother. A mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law." The gospel of our Lord. There's some good news for you. I'm glad you felt the impact of that. Isn't that funny to read in church about division and say the word of the Lord? Thanks be to God for the word of the Lord. Well, first of all, today I want you to take a deep breath and realize that Jesus is talking not here about sowing hostility, but he is talking about something that's required of us for this fire to be burning here on the earth. In St. Matthew's Gospel, there is a parallel passage, and Jesus says, "Don't think that I've come to bring peace. I've come to bring not peace, but a sword." And sometimes you might hear that and say, "Oh, great, a sword, now there's killing." But no, the sword is what divides. The sword's what separates. The sword is what creates some lines that are important. When I was praying about this gospel, I was thinking about my first year in the seminary, and one of the other men I was studying with came up with the idea that on, and I forget whether it was Thanksgiving or Christmas, one of those family holidays, right? Came up with the idea that what we ought to do now that we are here in the seminary is maybe what we should do is go and visit people who are in prison that day. It sounded like such a wonderful altruistic idea. After all, right? The corporal works of mercy, visit those who are in prison, visit those in hospitals and so forth. It sounded like a great idea. We were all congratulating ourselves for coming up with such a wonderful altruistic thing here, young men wanting to be part of building the kingdom of God. What I really remember about that is what happened when I told my family. I think it was one of my sisters who said, "Are you..." Never mind the rest of it. "What, are you kidding? Are you out of your mind?" And to tell you the truth, I don't remember how it really resolved. I don't remember if I went and, you know, went home later, or... I think the truth is I probably chickened out, faced with that expectation from my family. "What, are you going to do that? You're supposed to be with us. Supposed to be here. Don't be doing that." Interesting, isn't it? We read the gospel and you think of the call of the disciples. This is given to the disciples today, this passage. And we often think, oh, Jesus called them, they followed. Did everybody congratulate them? Was everybody happy about their leaving what they were doing, their ordinary work of fishing, carpentry, whatever, to be the followers of this preacher who shows up on the streets of Capernaum with a message that he intends to finally bring God's fire to the earth to transform this religion from kind of complicated historical mess into something powerful and unified, and they go off. Sometimes there's little descriptions of that, like Jesus is walking along the seashore and spies disciples in the boat with their father. And then the gospel says, and so they left the boats and their father and followed him. And I'm thinking, so there was Mr. Zebedee. He's in the boat. His boys just took off. Was he like saying, oh, that's so great. I am so glad that my sons have followed this. I'm glad that they're really that altruistic. Or was he saying, well, who's supposed to help me now? And after all I did for you, you go off and this and that and the other thing, right? I mean, there's the division point that Jesus is talking about. The most powerful thing are these allegiances to those who are around us and hold us and legitimately in love and in family. And yet he's saying something calls even beyond that. We're familiar with that in some ordinary ways. You know, a bit of it going on now. How many going off to college? That's the great social separator in our world these days, isn't it? You know, when I went to college, you lived home and took the train. You know, now everybody heads off and goes off to a different place, off on their own, and it's kind of that great moment of getting out of the, it's a good thing, out of the nest, on your own, test your skills. Try it out, be independent, not be having someone tell you what's going on all the time, what you need to do. And the moment, though, of letting go of that, you know, that's often probably pretty painful. And it's probably the young folks don't realize how hard it is to let you go. Don't, because you're so anxious to get let go. And parents, how hard it is to trust. And to affirm and to say this is good and to give your blessing. So you see there's really two sides of this. We are sometimes the person taking the step out. And sometimes we're the liberator. Sometimes we're the ones who let another go. Nothing is more clear than that to me than that it's part of why we have ritual weddings here in church. Yes, of course, for the two in love to make their vows of permanence and fidelity before God. That's absolutely important. But it's also the opportunity for the others, family who, in whose world they have grown up, to say to them, I set you free now. Be a family yourselves. And yes, there's those divisive moments of letting go. You can't be everywhere that you used to be all the time. And, you know, I heard conflict in families over that sometimes, right? It's a hard thing to do often. That's kind of one of the nice things about being a priest. You don't have to fight that out. You know, I know where I'm going to be. It's not that kind of a thing. And yet, what a power. And people do it in different ways. Some people make of it an arduous, painful kind of separation and letting go. Some people make of it liberating and affirming and full of blessing. And that's what Jesus is talking about today. He has come to change things in this world and wants people who are both willing to take the step out and also, because there's others listening to him speak this passage, that others will bless that stepping out and enable it to happen. If I had to ask you today, like, where is your stepping out? What would you think about that? Where have you stepped out and taken a step that others might not immediately affirm or bless? For some of you, I think just the fact that you are here today, you are already different than most of the world, so to speak. And maybe everybody in your other circles wouldn't say, oh, that's really wonderful. What'd you do on Sunday morning? Why did you do that? Maybe they wouldn't be that blessing of that, but for you to live on your own, if you will, to take a step to be true to who you are, that seems to be a very, very, very important thing. And so today we think about how we are set free, how we set others free, and for a very particular purpose. Jesus says this is to bring fire to the earth. Whenever you hear the fire, we think of the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful. Kindle us the fire of your love. Come, heal us, and we will be recreated. You'll renew the face of the earth. God wants something to happen in this world. And it only can happen when you and I, in countless little ways, can step away from the comfortable ordinariness of the circles of friends and family that kind of all fit together, and think for a moment a little differently, a little bit more broadly, a little bit more compassionately, a little bit more forgivingly, and in that light a fire. Maybe the fire sometimes burns, maybe it sheds light, but it's better than a dulling lack of fire. Only peace, no challenge, no real progress, no separation from too many ordinary things into something truly blessed by God. So no hostility in the words today, to put that idea away, that if you read the gospel again without thinking about that conflict kind of hostile thing, but to say how blessed we are when we let go and allow the presence of God to fill us. Let's stand together now. Let's profess the faith that we share. We pray the words today of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. My friends, let us bring all of our longings, our desires, and our hungers to the Lord today, confident that God will heal and satisfy every desire.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for peace in our world, for those who preach and practice the gospel of peace among the nations, in families and communities, between friends and workers, for tolerance instead of war, for dialogue instead of violence, for forgiveness instead of retribution, for military service women and men, for their safe return, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the church, for Pope Francis and Bishop Barres, for Father Mike and for all those who lead the minister in this parish, for the grace to embrace one another as true neighbors and partners in the life of faith, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for students going back to school, for those who learn easily and those who struggle with their lessons, for teachers and catechists and all those who are charged with the formation of the young, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick, for the names of the sick listed in our parish bulletin, and our book of intentions. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have died, especially Anne Antoletti and Carolyn Schneider, and for those who are grieving the loss of someone dear to them. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. At this Mass, we pray especially for people of the parish, and Celestino and Giuseppina Gambino, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, we bring all of our prayers before you today. We pray them in the name of Jesus and the power of the Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
As we bring our gifts to the table of the Lord, let us join our voices in singing Take Our Bread, which can be found in your music program. Again, let's Take Our Bread.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive our offering, O Lord, by which is brought about a glorious exchange, that by offering what you have given, we may merit to receive your very self through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live, we move, and we have our being. Each day you show us your love, your Spirit dwelling within, giving us here on earth the hope of unending joy. For your gift of the Spirit who raised Jesus from death is the foretaste and the promise of an eternal feast in heaven. In thankful praise and company with the saints, we glorify your power. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed, entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new, the eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, John, our Bishop, and with all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, all those who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Pray together now for the building of God's kingdom in the words Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope at the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord Jesus, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of our Lord be with you always. Let's to each other extend a sign of God's saving peace.
Lamb of God, you take away
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who take away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. And as we are receiving the Eucharist here in our church today, we invite those who join us online to also be one in prayer and in lifting our minds and spirits to God as we are in the presence of Christ today.
Please open your music program and join in singing today's communion hymn, As Grains of Wheat.
Join us after Mass at our hospitality tent. Today, our hosts are the Knights of Columbus. Take a moment for coffee, cold drinks, and refreshments, and to get to know your fellow parishioners and visitors. Tours of our beautiful basilica are available after the 9:30 Mass each weekend in the summer. Please meet in front of the altar after Mass to learn about our art and history. Do you love the majestic soaring music of the brass ensemble? Then you will not want to miss our next summer concert featuring Real East End Brass Band, led by Christopher Mandato, who is part of the SHJM family. This is a concert you don't want to miss. So grab your lawn chair or blanket and join us this Tuesday, August 16th at 6:30 p.m. Our annual summer appeal is ongoing. We cannot be a vibrant parish all year long without the special opportunity of support. Please be as generous as your means allow. Additional envelopes are at the doors of the church. Monday, August 15th is the Feast of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. This feast is not a day of obligation this year, but we invite you to join us for Mass at 9 a.m. Mass will be followed by the Rosary led by our Legion of Mary. Thank you for praying together with us today. Each weekend, our bulletin is full of upcoming events and activities happening here at Sacred Hearts. Please take home a copy.
So this week, our summer concert is the last of our outdoor concerts on the lawn. After that, we have more classical music. We have a string quartet, violins the following week after that. So that doesn't work out so well in the middle of the lawn. But this week, Real East End Brass sure does. And Chris Mandato is a, Chris and Maura were our youth ministers here a ways back. And now they're working on a family together. But Chris is a great brass player and often here for Christmas and Easter. You don't want to miss this. They are awesomely good and powerful. So be here on Tuesday night. Do come by and take a tour of the church, especially if you're visiting or here for the first time. Learn what makes this a basilica and what about the cool artwork and many shamrocks and other things that are part of our parish life here. That tour starts in front right after Mass today. And I also want to mention that I am leading a trip to the Holy Land this coming March, and the information on that is in the bulletin. I'm gonna have a information night a week from Monday, but that is like the ultimate pilgrimage to go to the place where Jesus actually lived, so think about joining us for that trip. Let's pray and give God thanks today. Made partakers of Christ through these sacraments, we humbly implore your mercy, Lord, that conformed to his image here, we may merit also to be co-heirs to his life in heaven, the one who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord is with you. May God bless us now and always, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We go in peace to love to serve our Lord. Thank you again all for praying together. Thanks to the folks who join us online. Thank you if you're visiting. We always are happy to have you here. And I hope you have a beautiful day today and enjoy this luscious weather.
Thank you, Father. Our sending forth hymn this morning can be found in your music program. Please stay and sing with us, Blessed Be the Lord. Once again, that's Blessed Be the Lord.